Thanks, Mark, and thanks everyone for sticking around for the last talk of our session for the day. It's kind of a little change of pace. Everybody's been talking about their research, and this guide is really bringing together all the different types of research that's happened in a tool for practitioners, managers, and researchers alike in a guide to coral reef restoration. This is volume one of the guide focusing on in-situ nurseries and outplanting. I'll focus on the outplanting section of the guide to show you what we've brought together for the tools that are available for that. This is a product of the CRC Field-Based Propagation Working Group, and we've been working on this for a number of years and hopefully get this out within the year's time, within this year. So there's what we've done here is this is a compilation of all the guides and publications that have been out and about for restoration. We aren't really reinventing the wheel, but what we found in restoration is that people are struggling to bring in all of the data. So what we're doing is bringing it all together in one guide for actually the time that's happening. You know, things are changing. As I know that this even conference, we're seeing new and new things. So that's why on the first slide, I said this is version one. This is a living document that will change and be iterated through time as practitioners find new ways to do restoration, and we're scaling up our restoration practices. So what we've come up with in this guide is bringing together all the different components to restoration, and I put this as these gears that work together, because without one of these, really your restoration program will not be as successful or as efficient as it could be. And so we start with within the guide, these are all the major topics that we go through, starting with your restoration planning. And each of these little subjects are supported through research or other guides that are out there already. For the purpose of this section, I'm just gonna focus on our outplanting and site selection, the design and techniques in which we've covered within the guide. So a lot of talks today in particular, and some of the plenaries as well, have really indicated how important site selection is. And we indicate that as well within our guide and how important finding your site is prior to starting your restoration. So that's first and foremost in the guide, is going out and selecting those restoration sites. We walk you through a three-step process. The first step is actually identifying the geographic areas, is what we call it. We indicate this is a desktop survey where you're looking at the presence of the species that you may be working with, the depth, substrate types that are there, water quality, connectivity, and human impact. And for this particular area, this is Dry Tortugas, we may draw on a map these orange boxes or polygons of areas that we'd be interested in for restoration based on that desktop survey. And then the next step is doing site selection, where we provide information on how to do an in-situ survey. So you're actually looking at the community that's within those areas that you've designated. The predators, space competitors, sediment, is there room for your restoration to expand? So after you've planted, can it have room to grow, or have you already limited your restoration? Is there actually space to plant your corals? What's the substrate like? Maybe bringing some nails with, or whatever method you might be using, and test that while you're out looking at this site. And then, of course, the goals and incentives of your program. Does that site meet those goals and areas? And how we plan, or how we think of you doing this, is within that area, your geographic area, you would select different sites in there and do the survey across that geographic area in a numerous number of different sites so that you can be confident when you go back out that these actually particular areas meet the needs of your restoration program. And in addition, once you have selected those sites, this is where you would also start your baseline data collection in order to really inform your restoration success in the future. Within the guide, we also provide ways to do this. We don't just tell you you should look at these. We provide case studies. So this particular case study was done by TNC and the USVI, where they use these criteria to create what they call the resilience score. So in orange here, they have the resilience score, and blue is the success of their restoration, the survival of their outplants. So in particular, they use this scoring sheet in which they found this resilience score. And what they found is a correlation between high resilience score, high outplant success. So we provide guidance of this study and also a different, I guess, a different study to show different ways that you can be evaluating your sites. Then the third step to your actual restoration is doing restoration design. So within that site selection, we indicate you should go out and annotate your site. So you're going in and really drawing where things should go. You're taking GPS points, you're drawing geographic features that will help you navigate across a site, certain particular areas that you'll be working with, measuring those areas so that you can go back out next and really start your restoration. We indicate where on the reef that should go. So in particular, maybe if the current typically runs this way, maybe you want to be planting more towards this way so the current can take any, if your species works through fragmentation, would generally take it across the site instead of into a sandy area. We also talk about spacing and density. So we've heard a few talks already today about the difference of looking at spacing and density of your corals. So we talk about things to think about during that time and the literature that supports those decisions that you can make. And also, we talk about the difference in the reproductive mode of those species and how that can influence your spacing and density of the corals when you outplant them. This in particular is a table that we have for the Caribbean species, and we have literature that supports Pacific species as well. Colony health, this goes for both directions, looking when you're doing your surveys, how healthy is the site, how healthy are the colonies there, but also we talk about how healthy are your corals when you remove them from the nursery. So suggesting that you're not removing unhealthy colonies, that will set you up for maybe not as good of success in your restoration program if you're outplanting unhealthy colonies. And then we go into colony size. I think Andrew has a really tiny colony that he's outplanting, little tiny nubbins. And this is gonna vary on your program, whether you're using microfragments or you're using your goals may be different about planting larger colonies, but we also provide information on how to select what or what size colony that you should be using. So then we jump into how do you attach your corals. So we provide tables. It's just an example of one of the tables. It's not the entire table of different attachment methods that are used most commonly throughout restoration thus far. We list the approximate cost of those. So giving practitioners, managers, scientists an idea of what they can be going forward to and what the cost would be per method. And that's based on the number of colonies per 100 colonies or 100 corals outplanted. So $1 sign is less than $10 per 100 colonies put out. Then we look at time, and this is an estimate based on our expertise as the authors and reaching out to practitioners on how often or how much time it takes them to plant one coral using that method, which includes everything from scrubbing the substrate and mixing, if you're using an adhesive, mixing the adhesive and how much time it would take to plop that coral on the reef. We provide basic advantages or disadvantages to each of those techniques, and we've broken them into different coral morphologies, branching and columnar, and we had a bunch of discussions on this and whether that should be expanded, but from this point, we decided that branching, which would include the digitate, folios, bushy, or arborescent, those techniques are pretty similar for those types of corals, whereas you have your mounding or boulder or coral or columnar, which require a little bit different type of outplanting techniques. And then we provide citations, a book of citations for you to also look through to support your method or to look at any lessons that they may have learned through the process and the data they may have collected. We also provide a little bit more detail on each of those, which can include some pictures of how the method looks in the field, the morphology that it's used, and go into the installation notes, so how you should be going about that, the recommended materials that you need to actually utilize that method. This particular method, it only requires 3 materials. Other methods require a long list of materials, so it also gives you an idea as a practitioner or user of these methods what you need to accumulate to actually get this method in the water. And then we list a bunch of important considerations to think about as these methods have grown over time, what people have learned while using those methods. I don't know what happened there, but so we also provide information on how to tag your corals and bringing together what has been used in the field. Again, we look at these pros and cons and important notes about each type of coral or of tag that you could be using. In particular, these livestock tags, people have found that different colors work well, but other colors really over time, the UV breaks down that color and now you're stuck with two of the same colors over time. The reds and the pinks turned into the same white coloration. So just some of those things to help you increase and your success and efficiency in restoration. As we grow, we also know that you can't map every single coral. So we provide information on how you can map your corals and track them over time so that you're not tagging every single coral, but maybe taking an area and mapping out your site. And so we provide guidance and example and case studies on how to monitor and map your colonies or your outplant sites. And then finally in our guide, we are approaching scaling up. And we do this through a number of different case studies on how people and programs have approached scaling up within their program. This particular case study is done in Belize and Puerto Rico, where they found that within their nursery, they're gonna grow corals on lines and they take that entire line and outplant it and can outplant much faster than if they were taking one coral and outplanting it to the reef. I think you saw earlier, the method in Puerto Rico, where they're doing secondary clippings from the outplants. So instead of going back and forth to the nursery, they're utilizing their outplants already, increasing the efficiency and abundance at one nursery site or at an outplant site. You heard about the coral ring from Andrew here, another way to increase your efficiency. You're already utilizing the attachment method. You're putting it into the nursery coral, and away you go. You're not adding anything else to that coral. In Colombia, they use a chessboard design in order to outplant their corals in a different little chessboard design in thinking of propagation across the site, so their area of impact is larger at a faster pace than if you were outplanting them all together. And I think one of the most important things that we show in this guide is that there's not a one-size-fits-all method, and I think we've heard that across all of our days here so far, and that's really what we're trying to present, that every program is going to be a little bit different, but we're providing you the guidance to select the methods and path forward for you to be the most successful. We realize not everything is included in here, and we know that restoration is growing very quickly, and so we will make this document updated as soon as we can with those new methods as well. And last, we have other tools within our guide as well. We've incorporated a database in here, so the data that you're collecting can be entered into a database. This database is quickly changing. They're debuting a new one this week. We have an evaluation tool for you to enter your data and look at how your program's doing. And then finally, we are developing these one-pagers, which I have a few left if anybody would like some, where we walk practitioners through different nursery techniques. We provide them a shopping list and a diagram, detailed ways to put together that particular nursery method, and lessons learned in which you can actually take this to the store, buy your goods, and sit in your lab, garage, and put them all together for you. This guide was put together by a ton of people and a ton of helpers. Without them, it wouldn't be where it is. And you will be able to find it here soon. Hopefully, very soon.